Kimberly. I'd like to thank the Canadian Cancer Survivors Network for inviting me here today and everybody else for calling in. Could you go to the next slide, please? Okay. We've actually known that some jobs have an increased risk of cancer for many years, and in fact, the earliest well-established one was about 200 years ago, and that was chimney sweeps. Many of you may have seen, maybe quite some time ago, even when you were young, the movie Mary Poppins, which has a number of chimney sweeps in the story. It's actually a fairly, the true story around chimney sweeps is fairly dark. After the Great Fire of 1666 in London, it became fashionable to have very long, circuitous chimneys that would, I guess people thought was aesthetically nice, but ironically increased the risk of having another fire. And the way they solved this was by hiring small boys who were usually orphans or the children of the poorest in the city, who were lowered down these chimneys to clean them. And these little kids basically spent their childhood just covered in soot. And that soot, as it turns out, increased their risk of cancer, and particularly scrotal cancer. Now, an alert clinician, Sir Percival Pod, he was knighted later, actually identified this in the chimney sweeps, and eventually this led to reforms in the 1840s to prohibit the use of small kids for this. But this is, I think, a kind of was the first official, you know, identification of a chemical carcinogen. But also, in the history of this kind of research of workplace cancer, is one of the first things where we're really closely linked with social reform. Could I have the next slide, please? These days, we actually see, I think, certainly in Toronto, but I think around the country, the issue of workplace cancer getting increasingly into the news, whether that's our old industrial facilities or places like nail salons, whether it's asbestos, which was just banned this year, or pesticides, where there's a lot of controversy. We're starting to see more and more of this in the news, and I think it's raising a lot of awareness of the fact that this is a much bigger issue than many people had known. Could I have another slide, please? And, you know, there's the assumption often that workplace cancer only really affects a small number of industrial workers or people in mines or things like that. But as this kind of montage of different photos is supposed to show, in fact, a lot of people in various various types of jobs are exposed to workplace carcinogens or suspected workplace carcinogens, whether that be even people in hair salons or in healthcare, as well as many other the different groups that you see here. Could I have the next slide, please? I'm going to talk a little bit before I talk specifically about Canada, about the International Agency for Research on Cancer. This is a specialized agency of the United Nations that has been around since 1965, and since 1970 has had a program to identify the things that cause cancer. And this is a very important thing for cancer prevention, this classification of carcinogens, and it's involved a lot of different workplace carcinogens over time. Could I have the next slide, please? The kinds of things that IARC, which is what the acronym is, evaluates include things like chemicals, metals, and dust, various forms of radiation, biological agents, which include things like bacteria and viruses, a lot of pharmaceuticals, personal habits like smoking or drinking, but also what we call exposure circumstances, which might include employment in particular industries and occupations, as well as other things. And I'll talk about some specific examples of these as we go along, because many of these occur in workplaces. So here you see just a summary of the classifications that IARC uses. And overall, they've reviewed about 1,000 different what they call agents, because there's so many so much variety in the kinds of things that they review. But over their 45 years or so that they've been running this program, they've reviewed over 1,000 different things for their whether or not they can cause cancer. And about half of those have either been placed in a possible, a probable, or a definite cancer classification. And over half of those were things that you could run into in the workplaces, or either primarily occurring in workplaces or things that might be encountered by people in workplaces, even if they are also encountered elsewhere. So, for instance, we have things like cigarette smoke, which people smoke themselves, but secondhand smoke occurs in workplaces, or various pharmaceuticals, which cause cancer and might have a benefit to the patients that are taking them, but to healthcare workers, in fact, they represent an increased risk of getting cancer. Can I have the next slide, please? Can I have the next slide, please? Oh, no, we are on the next slide. That's good. So these classifications, oh, no, I'm sorry. I missed that it flipped. There we go. Now, I guess we should say why these classifications are important. It's more than just an exercise for the scientists involved. It actually is important because when IARC classifies something as causing cancer, agencies all over the world react with regulations to prevent exposure to these carcinogens. And so it impacts in Canada in particular what the allowable levels of exposure are in workplaces, what pesticides can be used, how we label things at work through the WMIS program for some of those, some of you who may be aware of that. But it also stimulates a lot of voluntary actions by employers to reduce exposure, and as well encourages people who work in different situations or unions to also push for changes in what is allowed in workplaces. So it has a big impact on preventing exposure. Could I have the next slide, please? The reason I think that the network became aware of the work that my center does is this report that we put out, and it's the burden of occupational cancer in Ontario, but we're actually preparing a national burden of occupational cancer report that will be coming out shortly. And I'll actually make the network aware of that so that they can people who want to get a hold of a copy can do that. Can I have the next slide? This report has a lot of different information on workplace carcinogens in it. It was prepared by a national team of researchers from across the country and was funded by the Canadian Cancer Society. So researchers from Quebec and British Columbia, certainly Ontario, and then our collaborators in other provinces helped to put this together and look at what we were and review the kind of facts that we were putting out. The objective was to identify how many cancers are caused by workplace exposures, and also to identify how many people are exposed currently to those carcinogens, and also how those cancers could have been prevented and can be prevented moving forward through various types of actions, if those be policies or actions taken by employers. So the next slide, please. Now, in looking at prevention, what we tried to do was think of the most effective ways to prevent things. And I'm sorry this turned out a bit dark. This is a graphic that was produced by the U.S. National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health. And things that are up at the top are the most effective. So totally eliminating carcinogens, such as when we ban particular pesticides or we stop certain practices that result in cancer. That's certainly at the highest level. And sometimes we can also just substitute things out by taking less toxic chemicals, for example. We can also use different technology to reduce levels of exposure in the workplace or change workplace rules, or the last resort, which is providing personal protective equipment, though, as we ask people to wear masks to not allow chemicals to enter their lungs. Let's go to the next slide. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is something that certainly has been in the news a lot over the years, and that I presume everybody is well aware of, and that's asbestos. Canada did ban asbestos this year, but you know, in the past, Canada was one of the major producers of asbestos in the world, and we were a major exporter of asbestos to many other countries, and that just ended really only about 5 years ago. Today, or this year, there's over 500 new cases of mesothelioma diagnosed each year in Canada that are due to asbestos. And for every one of those, there are a number of lung cancers that are also caused. So almost 2,000 lung cancers every year occur that were caused by asbestos. Most of the people who are diagnosed with mesothelioma or lung cancer will not survive it. These are terrible forms of cancer. In particular, 5-year survival for mesothelioma is very low, only about 7% the last time it was analyzed. And the economic costs are certainly big. $2.35 billion every year is what we estimated the cost of just those two cancers due to asbestos. There are other cancers that are also caused, cancers of the larynx, the ovaries in women, stomach and colorectal cancers can be caused by asbestos. And then people can also die of non-cancer diseases such as, it says silicosis there, but it should be asbestosis. And about 80 people die of asbestosis every year in Canada. But there's thousands of people who have impaired lungs because of that, scarred lungs that don't work as well. Could I have the next slide, please? This is just a graph of the number of mesotheliomas. And the only established cause of mesothelioma is exposure to asbestos or other things that are very similar to asbestos, but are pretty rare here in Canada, but other types of minerals. And what you see here is the number of cancers diagnosed every year. The green line is Ontario, and you can see the number climbing every year. But you also see the red line, which is Quebec. Quebec has a much smaller population than Ontario, but it has the highest rates of mesothelioma in the country. And it's the place where the majority of asbestos has always been mined in Canada, and a lot of the asbestos industries have been located. But across the country, most provinces are still increasing in the number of mesotheliomas that are diagnosed every year. Can we have the next slide, please? Now, there are still about, we believe, 150,000 Canadians who are still regularly exposed at work. That is, every week or so, they'll encounter asbestos, some of them every day. This includes people who are involved in asbestos remediation, removing asbestos from buildings, people who are involved in really doing any kind of repairs or maintenance of older buildings. Now, almost any public building that is older than about the mid-1970s has a lot of asbestos that's still in it. And that was put in back then because it was thought to be a safety measure, that it would prevent those, you know, places like schools and hospitals from burning down. But behind the walls and in the ceilings, there's still asbestos in many of those buildings. We need to do, although now we've banned asbestos, that's really just banning the new use of asbestos, and that asbestos that is still in buildings and in things like ships and other types of circumstances, that's still there until it's actively removed. So we still will have people exposed for many years, and we have to take additional measures. That is actively removing asbestos from buildings. We've asked for the creation of a building registry for all public buildings and workplaces. We've recommended that. Right now, there are building registries for federal buildings and government buildings in the province of Saskatchewan. But we really need more of these things so that when people go to work on these buildings, they know where the asbestos is and how to safely avoid being exposed. British Columbia has actually established an interministerial working group to talk about how to further protect people from asbestos. And we think that that would be an important thing to be adopted in other provinces as well. Go on to the next slide. Probably something that people don't often think about is exposure to the sun. Not when you're out getting a suntan or in a park, but for people who work out in the sun. There are about 1.5 million people in Canada who work outdoors the majority of the time. That's either in construction or agriculture, but it can also be among public works people, people who work in recreation, gardeners. Lots of different groups really spend the majority of their time outdoors. And we're estimating that approximately 4,600 skin cancers are caused every year in these outdoor workers. And they're usually non-melanoma skin cancers is what we call them. So they're less deadly than the melanoma skin cancers, but they're still a cancer. They can still be a very serious thing and actually cause, you know, and be fatal in some cases. We have the next slide. The exposure to sun in the workplace is another thing that can be often prevented, not all the time, but one way to do that is to create shade. And that can be through portable shade structures or providing canopies, you know, over different types of equipment or where people work. Another thing is to, where it's possible, avoid outdoor sun exposure by in between 11 and 3, when the sun is most intense, certainly in the summer in Canada. We've also recommended that workplaces that have outdoor workers should develop sun safety programs in the same way that we've tried to, I think, in Canada, begin to develop sun safety practices for non-workplace exposures. This is an important cause of cancer, and it really is underrecognized in Canada. Could I have the next slide, please? Diesel engine exhaust is another thing that a lot of people don't realize causes cancer. Pretty much when we burn any kind of, we call organic material, whether that be fuel or wood or other things, we produce this kind of dark smoke that contains, you know, stuff that's very similar to the soot that those chimney sweeps were exposed to many years ago. And in the case of diesel engine exhaust, the exhaust itself is composed of very, very small particles that can pass deep into the lungs and even pass through the lungs and into the body. About 5 years ago or so, diesel engine exhaust was classified as a cause of lung cancer by IARC, the International Agency for Research on Cancer. And we estimate that there are 560 lung cancers caused by diesel exhaust every year. And we also suspect that there are a lot of bladder cancers caused by diesel exhaust as well. That's one where the evidence is still being collected, but one where we think it's pretty accurate. There's a lot of things we can do to reduce diesel engine exhaust exposure. And some of that is to upgrade or replace old equipment, whether that be trucks, and that's gradually happening as we get more efficient diesel engines. But also what we call off-road equipment, like this stuff you see in the picture here for construction, or equipment that's used in underground mining. That also has to be replaced in order to reduce diesel exhaust exposure. Now, sometimes we can use alternative fuels to reduce exposure. We can put in technology that basically shuts down a piece of equipment when it's not being used, so stops it from idling, or put in rules that require that equipment not be left idling, which is often what is done, which means that those pieces of equipment are continuing to generate diesel exhaust even when they're not being used. And then there's other various types of technology and regulations that are needed. I have the next slide, please. Crystalline silica is another thing that causes lung cancer. A lot of workers in construction and mining are exposed to crystalline silica. Now, it's the same thing that you might lay on when you're on the beach. But when this kind of fine silica is in the air and it can be breathed into the lungs, it actually has the ability to cause lung cancer. We think about 200 lung cancers are caused each year from silica exposure. It can be replaced in some types of settings, and that can be through ventilation as well. We can reduce, or filtration systems, we can reduce the silica that's in the air. We can replace it with other things when we're doing stuff like sandblasting. We can also try to clean it up, but that has to be done with either wet systems or vacuuming in order to make sure that it doesn't get back into the air. Because when we're drilling or cutting or grinding or trying to clean things up, it's easy to put dust into the air. So there's a lot of things we can do to reduce silica exposure. Can we go to the next slide, please? Something that many people, I think, may not have thought about is that work at night is also suspected of causing cancer, in particular breast cancer, but it's suspected of other cancers as well. About anywhere from 12 to 20% of people work either all or part of their days in the evening, you know, at night, or I shouldn't say days, but they work their hours at night or in the evenings. And this raises the possibility of disrupting what we call our circadian rhythms. Working at night and being exposed to light at night actually changes hormone levels within the body, and can actually increase the risk of breast cancer. At least that's what we believe. It's something that's still being researched. But what that research is currently saying is that there could be up to 1,200 breast cancers each year caused by this exposure to working at night. And it's hard to avoid in some situations. You know, we need our hospitals to really operate all night. We need public safety to go on all night. People expect hotels and restaurants to be open late into the evening. But there may be some ways that we organize the scheduling of when people work that we can reduce their cancer risk. Let's go to the next slide, please. Welding fumes have also been classified as a cause of cancer, and it was recently evaluated and moved up to being a definite human carcinogen, and this just happened a few years ago. And over a 500,000 people, we believe, you know, do welding at work. And what this welding does is, you know, you see the kind of bright flashes of light and things, but what happens is when that metal is heated, that it turns into what we call a metal fume, very fine particles in the air that again can be breathed deep into the lungs. And we believe that's causing lung cancer in workers that are doing almost any type of welding. Now we can try to put in ventilation, that is things that pull that kind of dust out of the air, but it is something that is sometimes hard to control, and we definitely do need to control it in order to prevent exposure and cancer. Can we have the next slide, please? Environmental tobacco smoke, so being exposed to secondhand smoke at work, has been in the past an important cause of cancer. Every year we think there's 130 lung cancers and smaller numbers of cancers of the pharynx and larynx that are caused among people who never smoked cigarettes, just because of exposure to cigarettes from people that they worked with. Now these days, we've got pretty good regulations in place, and almost all workplaces really don't allow smoking in the workplace and require that people at least go outside to be able to smoke. But according to the Canadian Tobacco Use Monitoring Survey, there still are many people who are reporting exposure to secondhand smoke at work. And we do need to continue to work on improving our smoking policies in the workplace. Can I have the next slide, please? Radon is something that I think many people hear about in the news. There's lots, I think, of promotion of trying to test for radon at home, although a lot of people still need to test for radon at home. And the word has been spread that this is a major cause of lung cancer, above and beyond cigarette smoking. This is considered the second most important cause of lung cancer in Canada. Even though it's often just covered for homes, it's also something that does occur in workplaces. And, you know, the things that people are most aware of, I think, might be mines where people are deep underground and might get exposed to radon. But it can also happen in workplaces that are above ground, but in areas that the same areas where there's high levels of radon in people's basements at home, there could be radon at their workplace as well. A challenge is that radon is colorless and odorless. You can't smell it. You can't see it. You don't know if you're being exposed until you test for it. So we know a lot of ways to reduce radon exposure, but the important thing is that we have to monitor for it to know whether it's there or not. Have the next slide, please. Okay, so this is just a summary slide of most of the things that I've talked about today in terms of the numbers of cancers and the numbers of people exposed. And these are the top 10 known and suspected workplace carcinogens in Canada in terms of the numbers of cancers that are caused every year, or that we believe are caused every year. And so you see solar UV, asbestos, diesel exhaust, crystalline silica, welding fumes, the as well, nickel and chromium, which are two carcinogenic metals that are found in welding fumes, but also can be found elsewhere. Environmental tobacco smoke, radon. PAH is something I didn't talk about. It's another suspected thing more broadly, but when I was talking about that, when you burn things that result in smoke, a lot of that smoke is what we see are polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which you call PAHs, that cause lung cancer and skin cancer and bladder cancer. So these are all important causes of cancer in Canada. And the number of people currently exposed are things that we've identified through the Carex Canada project. And if you're interested in that, you can just Google up Carex Canada and you'll get to the website. And it has a lot of information on workplace exposures in there. Can we have the next slide, please? What I didn't talk about today are a lot of other things that are suspected human carcinogens, and that includes things like pesticides, which are a big, perhaps controversial issue. And most of these pesticides are classified as probable or just possible human carcinogens. And that's what that 2A means there, is that it's probably carcinogenic. And when it says group one, that means it's definitely carcinogenic. These are some of the pesticides that have recently been evaluated. And some of these are still used in Canada. That's become a bit of a controversy. And you may have heard about this in the news. And certainly there are people who disagree with some of these classifications. But nonetheless, these are things that are moving forward and people are becoming more aware of. Could I have the next slide, please? So in conclusion, occupational cancer is more common in Canada than most people think. There are many well-established causes of cancer in the workplace. I've given you some of the major ones, but there are many more. And there are certainly many more that are suspected above and beyond that. So it's an area where we're continuing to do research and continuing to identify new workplace carcinogens. These results, even the known workplace carcinogens, the really well-established ones, they result in over 10,000 new cancers a year in Canada. So this is, not a minor cause of cancer. It definitely is one of the more important causes. Although, it's not as big as cigarette smoking, it still is an important one. And one of the reasons it is important is that there are millions of people exposed, and we could prevent exposure and eliminate those cancers. So we could be have a lot less cancers every year in Canada if we did prevent exposure to those carcinogens, or at least begin to take action against them. Could I have the next slide, please? That's it for what I wanted to present today, and I'm hoping that there are questions that I can answer that people have. But if you like, I have on here our website, occupationalcancer.ca, that you're welcome to visit. And I wanted to thank some of the funders of our center, which include the Canadian Cancer Society and the Government of Ontario, which includes the Cancer Care Ontario, which is the Provincial Cancer Agency, and the Ontario Ministry of Labour, which is an important contributor to our work. So I think I'll end there. We can go one more slide, which is just, this is a slide for the Canadian Cancer Survivors Network, and give you some additional information about how to contact them. So maybe I'll turn it back over to Kimberly now, and if there are questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Paul. Yeah, we got a couple in. So the first one, are there any possible initial viral exposure relating to prostate cancer?
Not that I know of at this time. You know, there's prostate cancer is, it's an important cancer. You know, it's one of the, it's the most commonly diagnosed in men. And there's a growing recognition of how important it is. Unfortunately, almost all the research that's been done on prostate cancer goes into treating the cancer, but there's been relatively little done on investigating the causes of prostate cancer. So we know relatively little about the causes of prostate cancer. And I don't know of any viruses that are associated with it.
All right. So the next one is, has there been any research conducted in relation to cat litter and the dust that is breathed in when replacing litter, since there is a significant difference in the quality of dust depending on the brand?
Not that I know of. You know, organic, we call organic dust, these kind of dust that would, I think, occur in cat litter. It's not something I know health effects of, but a lot of those kind of things are associated with lung disease and, you know, irritation, and sometimes people become allergic to dust, particularly if it's got some other kind of biologic material associated with it. But I'm not aware of any research on it regarding cancer at this point. At least none that I know of.
All right. And then the next one is, can marijuana smoke and or secondhand smoke from marijuana cause cancer?
You know, it's something that there's a lot of research being done on now. The assumption that people have made, which is pretty logical, is that if you smoked as much marijuana as people smoked cigarettes, that we would probably see cancer, because in fact the smoke is pretty similar to that. The thing is that people smoke less when they're smoking marijuana, at least everyone that I would know of does. You'd have to smoke a lot of it. But it is something that there's a lot of research on now, and even some focus on other types of cancer. So there's been several studies, for instance, that have found an increased risk of testicular cancer associated with cigarette smoke, or not cigarette smoke, but marijuana smoke. And that's something people are investigating some more. So it could be that it operates different than tobacco. But the assumption now is that probably will act as tobacco, but it's going to be more proportional than to how much people actually smoke and get into their lungs.
Okay, and then this question has multiple parts. So how can we test for radon? There are some kits being advertised to be used by individuals that you can purchase online. Are they reliable? How helpful the test can be if the result for radon is positive?
Well, there are a lot of kits out there. If I know that the Canadian Lung Association has kits available and may also be able to answer questions in terms of what is a good way to measure it. I know the Radiation Safety Institute of Canada does that kind of thing as well. There's a lot of good kits out there. It's not something where I know if there's anything that's being distributed that isn't good, but it's probably something to check into before you use it. The important thing for testing for radon is that you need to have the kits in place in general for a long time to really get a good sense for whether or not radon is a problem in a building. And where you place the kits is important. So it's important to get good instructions before you use a radon testing kit. But the thing is that if you know that there is radon in your home or in a workplace, it can be removed, and we can prevent that exposure to radon. And that can be through ventilation. It can be through sealing basements. or just ventilating basements before that radon can be recirculated elsewhere in a building. So it's definitely something that can be prevented. So you want to do the testing correctly in order to do that. And so I would stick with organizations that I would know and trust if I were to get radon testing. And the organization that I'm working with right now is the Canadian Lung Association.
All right. And then if diesel engine causes cancer, why does exhaust from gasoline engines not cause cancers?
Well, it's being investigated, but it seems to generate a little bit of a different kind of smoke. You know, when you see exhaust from diesel, it is kind of a black, almost oily looking smoke. And those black particles are small particles of carbon that can get deep into the lungs. Now, any kind of engine exhaust is bad for you if you inhale it. You know, it's a mix of toxic chemicals. So you certainly don't, I would say that all engine exhaust is bad, period. But in terms of cancer, it seems as though diesel is worse, and we believe it's because of those small particles that it generates.
Okay. And then, is it mandatory in workplaces for employers to inform their employees of possible carcinogens?
It's mandatory for places that use chemicals, so that if chemicals are brought into a workplace, what's called the WMIS regulations, which is the regulations that cover the labeling of different chemicals and require that we have what's called safety data sheets in workplaces that say what's in chemicals and what their health effects are. So that kind of stuff is regulated, but it's not necessarily, explicitly mandatory for employers to say if something is being generated in a workplace in another way, so that if it isn't being brought in as a chemical. That said, you know, an employer is supposed to provide a safe and healthy workplace. A challenge is that many smaller employers may simply be as unaware of hazards as the people who work in a place. They should try to find out and educate themselves, but they don't have the resources that a larger company might have in order to kind of, you know, have that information handy and make sure that all their managers understand it. So I think it's always important for people to try to make themselves as aware of as possible of hazards themselves, so that you can encourage your employer to take the proper steps in the workplace. But it is their responsibility to provide that kind of a safe workplace.
Right, and then you talked about pesticides. Is there any research between pesticides use and cancer, especially in agricultural?
Yeah, there's been a lot of research over the years in this, and that's why there's a lot of things now that are suspected of causing cancer, and why there's been some changes in recent years. A challenge that we've had in the past is that agricultural workers, you know, farmers, farm workers, they often handle multiple pesticides. And so even though we've seen increased rates of things like non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in agricultural workers, it's been hard to tie it to any one type of chemical or any one pesticide because people are exposed to a mix. In recent years, there's been some very large studies that have been conducted, and they're big enough to try to, you know, separate out the effects of these different pesticides. And so they use different statistical methods to analyze this data over decades to look at which of these chemicals are more likely to cause cancer. The other thing is that these chemicals can be tested on animals. That's still done in order to determine what causes cancer. It's still considered the most reliable way, even though we hope someday that'll be stopped as a practice. But right now, it still remains one of the major tools that we use to identify workplace cancers or other causes of cancers from chemicals. And that has helped point us towards the pesticides that are most likely to cause cancer.
Okay, and then are you able to comment on Agent Orange as a cancer-causing agent?
I can. It is one of those pesticides that is most strongly suspected or to be a cause of cancer. It's in a class called chlorpheniroxy herbicides. It's called a herbicide because it's a pesticide that's used to kill plants. And it was designed as a poison for plants. But as your caller probably knows, there are many people either in the military or other folks who may have been exposed to Agent Orange over time. Now, Agent Orange is a mix of chemicals, 2,4-5-T, which is the most important ingredient, and 2,4-D, which is also in there. These are still being evaluated for their carcinogenicity, but the stuff that was used in places like military applications in Vietnam was actually a fairly dirty form of this chemical, and we believe it was contaminated with things called dioxins, and dioxins are known to cause cancer. So exposure to those is more likely to cause cancer than the kinds that we use for agriculture, where they're we were more careful on making sure they're not contaminated with these other chemicals. Nonetheless, this is an area that is still being researched.
Okay, so we have time for any more questions. If there is, I'll just give a second. Great. I'd like to thank you again, Paul.
Okay, well, thanks for asking.